आबाद हुई कर्बला उजड़ा मदीना बर्बाद हुई मैं। यूं हजरते ज़ैनब ने कहा पीठ के सीना बर्बाद हुई मैं। एक दिन था के चादर मेरे सर से गिरी थी, सूरज भी न निकला, सर नंगे फिराता है मुझे आज कमीना बर्बाद हुई मैं। एक दिन था के इस शहर की करती थी मैं शाही, और आज तबाही बेगुस्ल पड़ा मोहरे नबुवत का नगीना बर्बाद हुई मैं। भाई मुए बेटे मुए जिंदा में फंसे है, वारिस नहीं कोई अब्बास नहीं जीते नहीं शाह हे मदीना बर्बाद हुई मैं। सलावात पर मोहम्मद
सल्लल्लाहु।
माय डियर ब्रदर्स सिस्टर्स फैकल्टी स्कॉलर्स एल्डर्स एंड माय चिल्ड्रन, सलाम अलैकुम व रहमतुल्लाहि व बरकातहू। This is last but one, and I have a few things that I would like to share with you, and they are all actually addressed to my own self, because I am also short a lot of things that I need to be jolted and I need to be woken up for. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنُرِيدُ أَن نَّمُنَّ عَلَى الَّذِينَ اسْتُضْعِفُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَنَجْعَلَهُمْ أَئِمَّةً وَنَجْعَلَهُمُ الْوَارِثِينَ. And we desire to bestow a favor upon those who are deemed weak in the land, and to them, and to make them the imams, and to make them the heirs. Many times I wonder that the legacy that the Aimma Tahirin have left us in the du'as, that at every moment of my life, one of the imams has left a legacy for me to take refuge with and from. You find that every du'a that we read, the du'a after every salat is there. There is du'a when we make wudu. There is du'a for every Friday. There is a du'a for every Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. They're all there. The greatest legacy that was left to us was by our fourth Imam, Imam Ali ibn al-Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. And that legacy is Sahifa Sajjadiyya. Some people are wondering that all these years that Zainul Abidin was the Imam, what did he do to manifest his imamat? What did he do to clarify his imamat and proceed with that teaching and that preaching and that reaching the way Amir al-Mu'mineen did, the way Hassan al-Mujtaba did, the way Aba Abdullah did, and the way his son, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, and his grandson, Jafar al-Sadiq did? What is it? What is it that he did? He did Sahifa Sajjadiyya. If we open Sahifa Sajjadiyya, you will notice that every political, social, familial, economic, and human ideas, nasihats, admonitions are all there in that. In Sahifa Sajjadiyya, there is admonition for me and for the king. There is nasiha for me and a slave. If there are hukukal, there is another one which is called hukukal, the rights.
Treaties of the rights.
Thank you. Salawat bar Muhammad. Risalatul Hukuk. In Risalatul Hukuk, you'll find that there is haq even for the tree. There is haq for a blind. There is haq for the king. There is haq for your children. And all are tabulated so nicely and so methodically that you will wonder, what is this that this fourth Imam of us did? Then I would recommend myself and all of us that we should revisit Sahifa Sajjadiyya, and not only those du'as that we read like the Makarimul Akhlaq and all that, but we should go for other small ones that are there for safety, for sickness, for travel. They're all there. So let us motivate ourselves from tonight, because Imam Ali ibn al-Hussein's journey begins from last night, and he is continuing on that journey till he is poisoned. So all that time he left us a legacy that we should revisit and see how it can apply to me. Salawat bar Muhammad. We are so notorious that we say a lot of things and we do not do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is clearly telling me, لِمَا تَقُولُ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Why do you say what you do not do? But we keep on doing that. And we continue in our fallacies and in our lusts and in our desires to achieve whatever that Allah, that we want to. There is a dua in the Shahr Ramadan that we read, which is called Dua Iftitah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and these are only two sentences, wa tatahabbabu ilayya fa atabaghazu ilayk wa tatawaddadu ilayya fala aqbalu mink. I extend my love to you. You are extending your hatred to me. I invite you to me. You reject my invitation. This is how we have lowered ourselves, that every year we have to be reminded of this. Not only do I reject it, فَأَتَبَغَّزُ إِلَيْكَ وَتَتَوَدَّدُ إِلَيَّ فَلَا أَقْبَلُ مِنْكَ. No, كَأَنَّا لِيَتَتَوُّلَ عَلَيْكَ. As if you are more superior than me. When you reject me in such a way that you are more superior than me. I have become a Fir'aun. If I follow that dua every year, then I should be a different person. Why do I have to have that what the Hindustanis are saying, churi bagal mein mukh mein ram? Why? I mean, everyone knows what I'm talking about. I don't have to go forward with that. I cannot be such a hypocrite that it's ram, 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 and I have something else in my armpit. It can't be. So we have to reevaluate ourselves. I have one more night to go, and then inshallah, we will go our separate ways, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be with you and us all. Salam. Salawat bar Muhammad. We talked about time, and he said, please do not abuse, use time. Time is a measure. Time is an amana. Time is a custody. We are born in time. We live in time, and we die in time. Time is the domain. What we do with time is what we do with our lives. Whatever we do with the time is what we do with our lives. Each one must realize that every moment that passes is an important opportunity gone. An opportunity came, I left it, it's gone, it will never come back. Used or abused, never to return. Soon time will be up and we will have to leave this physical world and give account for our lives. At that time, what will we say? There will be accounting there. The more we remind ourselves of the responsibility of the present, which we talked about it last night, that present is a gift. Yesterday was history. Tomorrow is a mystery. Today is present and it is a gift. P-R-E-S-E-N-T. If anybody gives me or I give you a present, we'll love it, won't we? It's a gift. Why don't we make a security for that gift? Why don't we use that gift properly? If somebody gave me a rose and I put it in the dustbin, is that the way a rose should be behaved with? If somebody gave me an apple and I did not eat it and left it on my desk until it rot, is that the way we do it? We take care of it, right? So likewise, time is a present for me. We live in the present moment, and the better the consequences for the future, for the better consequences of the future. In Surah Asr, we always say, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَأَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. The haq is there, the sabr is there. What are the characteristics of time? I've got six here, very quickly. Time passes quickly. Redeem the time, don't waste it, because we are living in a generation which is wicked. We talked about this in the third or the fourth majlis, how wicked the generation that we are living in. Small deposits of time over time will redeem your time. Tipe tipe sarovar barai. This is in Gujarati. The drop by drop fills a lake. For that, I would like to give you some examples. All of you, mashallah, are healthy. Yes? All of you work. You are all professionals and all that. You also go and do exercise. Some of you have treadmills at home, yeah? And my treadmill only stares at me every day. Come use me, you know? Now, if I decide that I'm going to go on the treadmill every day for 20 minutes, and I constantly am there on it 20 minutes every day on that treadmill, it will keep me healthy. It will keep me in a good physical. Thank you. Now, if I decide one fine day that 20 by 7 is 140 minutes, I'm going to do 140 minutes on Monday only and not do the rest of the week. And I go there for 100. What will be my condition after doing 140 minutes? I'll be out of breath. I'll be out of shape. So salah is something like that, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept for us five times salah at different times, in different stages, so that we go there, rejuvenate, refuel, and then go forward. If I say that I wake up in the morning late, I have my breakfast, and I don't even have my breakfast because I'm late, and I go to work, and I do my work until 5 o'clock, and I haven't said even my Zohreim because I was so busy, and then I come home, and I have to eat first because I'm hungry. So I eat, and then after that, Maghrib comes, and then Isha comes. And then at Isha, I say, oh yes, I have to pray my 17 rakat, and I go there, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. You know why? Because immediately I want to watch my 9 o'clock movie. This is common. And then at 11 o'clock, I sleep, and I start the same way. So time is very important that we utilize it methodically. We utilize it with wisdom, and we utilize it in the way that it has been created for us. Salawat bar Muhammad. Another example I'll give you, and this is very common, that we go and work very hard, and we save money, and we say that in 6 months I will have saved enough, I'm going to take my children for a cruise in the Mediterranean or in Florida or whatever. So I tell my children, don't worry, in 6 months we are going to have enough money, we'll go for the cruise. My child doesn't want the cruise. My child doesn't want to go to Florida. My child wants me. Rather than giving him that 6 months bonus, and when I go on a cruise and when I go there, I'm tired because I went to Disney and I had those hamburgers and I didn't have time to do this, I didn't have time to do that. And all the time, I'm spending time with my child, spending money so that he becomes happy. He will be happy if I came home and I spent 20 minutes with him, either before lunch or dinner or after, and have dinner together. There is an incident where a father comes home and the son goes and opens the door. The child opens the door and he throws his jacket to him. He puts it there. He says, how was your day? I was very tired, please. You know, no, don't worry. I don't have any homework today. I'm not going to ask you for the homework. He said, what is it? He said, may I ask you one question? He says, yes, Dad. He said, how much do you make per hour? He says, you know what? I make $40 an hour. He runs up into his room. He has $20 in his piggy bank. He brings it down and he's asked his father, can I borrow $20 from you? He says, he takes out $20 and he will go away. He takes the $20, put it with his $20. He's giving it to his father and says, I need 1 hour of your time if you can spend it with me. Salawat bar Muhammad. Isn't this a lesson for me? I am making all that money and I'm working so hard so that my child can have education and become a doctor or an accountant or an engineer. But in the meantime, that character building, that nurturing, that imamat, that qiyamat, that salat, that rosa, that Islam is not being manifested in my child because I'm busy doing making money and they are busy losing Islam. This is how it is. So we have to get that time to be utilized in a way that, first of all, the foundation or the nucleus of utilization of the time should be Islam, should be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then we will revolve around it. Salawat bar Muhammad. What does Allah want from me? This realization, this enlightenment of utility of time in a rightful way will redeem me for my salvation in this world and in the world hereafter. So my duty is having all this great value and importance. Duty is to be duly appreciated, managed, and there is no room for slogans like killing time. How many times we are killing time? What are you killing time for? There's no time to kill. The more you want to kill time, the more time is slipping away from you. These slogans do not belong to Islam. For in Islam, time is a real valuable. In fact, wasting time is much more dangerous than squandering money. Because property, unlike time, can be recouped somehow. If you lose a property, you may be able to make it back. Time, you will never be able to. Free time is a blessing that is overlooked and not wholly appreciated by many people. Salawat bar Muhammad. A Muslim should know how to organize his time and make a realistic plan for his worldly and religious duty without any of them overlapping one another. I'm not saying that we should not have recreation. We should not have sports. No, we should have. We should have relaxation. We should have entertainment. For all work and no play will make Jack what? A dull boy. I don't want to be a dull boy. I want to be a smart boy. To be a smart boy, you have to be able to allocate your time accordingly. One of the methods of managing time properly is for a Muslim to get up early in the morning. For our children, we say early to bed and early to rise makes a man healthy, wealthy, and wise. We tell our children all the time, but we are far from it. Get up early and sleep early. Our Aima are telling us that after Isha, you must go to sleep. Because you have then Salatul Fajr. And in between, those who are accustomed, they will do Salatul Layl. But no, if my program starts at 10 o'clock until 1 o'clock, I got to watch it on Wednesday night. Starting his day with prayer, the supplication of the morning brings the Muslim Allah's grace. His grace comes to us. A Muslim should always bear in mind that every time it has its own task that suits it. Doing tasks in their due times bring about peace of mind and comfort. Our waiting for the imam is time consuming. What about for the imam? How does he consume his time? Let's think about those things. How is he doing it? How does he use his cerebral capacity to be able to meet us all daily, everywhere on this earth? The same way, you and I, we have to find a solution to our capacity and be able to raise that cerebral capacity at a higher level than the dolphins. Mine is supposed to be 2%. Einstein is 10%. Dolphin is 15%. So dolphin is more intelligent than Einstein. We should have dolphins' pictures, not Einstein's pictures around. Huh? But if we were to raise our cerebral capacity higher, where will we be? Let me give you as an example of a man who said that I can bring the throne of Bilqis before you even wink your eye to Sulaiman. It is in the Quran. And Sulaiman winked his eye, blinked his eye, and the taht was there. Where did he get that? The Quran testifies that he had some knowledge of the book. Some knowledge of the book. What about the one to whom the book was revealed? What about the one who says, Ana Madinatul Ilm wa Aliyun Babuha? So there are people who have been given designations like Salman Muhammadi. And Prophet says, you can be like me. If you came to me, if you believe in me, you love me, you obey me, you do what I do, you disobey, you go away from what I'm telling you not to go, you will become like me. Your cerebral capacities will become higher and higher. And the morning prayers makes it higher. And better than that, the Salatul Layl. Why has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept it in the middle of the night? That we have to indulge in that so that our capacity and our enlightenment and our wisdom and our capacity to think, to be able to digest, to be able to perform, to be able to equate, to be able to give that humanness that I have, the way Hussein did, to others. These are the kind of things that we have to learn from Hussein. These are the kind of things we have to learn from Karbala. Salawat bar Muhammad. I wanted to talk about two things, but I'm going to leave one for tomorrow, and that is to talk about the four naibs of the Imam. Inshallah, tomorrow I will concentrate only on that. But tonight I'm going to finish with a story, and then we'll go to Masaib. There was a country where they had a king who was only for 1 year. After 1 year, the king was taken to an island and left there. But for one whole year, he was the king. How do they choose the king? They say that the first person who comes through the gates of this city, he will be made into the king. So this person who entered the gate, and he's taken with pomp and glory, and he's made into king, and he's kept on the throne. He says, this is your country. You can govern it the way you want. He said, for how long? Maybe he was smart. He said, for how long? He said, for 1 year. And then afterwards, he said, you'll be taken to an island, and you'll be left there on your own. He said, okay. He slept the night. Next morning, he said, I would like to go and visit that place. I don't know where he was from, Hyderabad, or he was a Khoja, I don't know. But he was taken to that island, and when they went, the people who were in the boat, they were scared even to go there. They said, we leave you here. He said, okay, leave me here. He was left there, and what he hears is the growling of the animals. You know, the wild animals, they're waiting for somebody to devour. He walks around and he sees the skeletons of human beings. The place is dahshat, as they say. It is very, very scary place. He comes back. Next, a day passes, a week passes. He says, now I want, who is a mason here, who is a carpenter here, who is a plumber here. He takes all those craft people, he takes them to that island. And he says, who is here with arrows and bows and guns? And they say, we are here. He takes all these people, because he's a good king. They kill the animals, the wild animals. The place becomes cleared. Remove all the skeletons. The place is desolate. So now what do? There's no water. Dig a well. There is no electricity. Make a wheel. There is no trees. Let us plant trees. So all these things are being done as quickly as this man can, with fruits and flowers and vegetables and all those things he's planting there. So now that place has become a garden, a heaven for the king, who is neglected all in the world except to do that amal so that he can have the garden there. When the year passes, they say, all right, it's all done. He said, okay, take me there. Oh, yes, he took some goats and lamb and cow. You know, we like meat and chicken. And he kept them all there, made a farm there. Everything was working. There were slaves there. He kept his slaves and his workers and everything. And he went there. And when he went there, they were all there to welcome him. Welcome, Lord, you have come. This is your kingdom now. That man was smart, wasn't he? The rest of them were all devoured by the wild. Now you and I, we can take a lesson from this small little story that this world is a garden, is a farm. Whatever you sow here, you will reap there. So if you sow here a flower, you'll get a flower there. If you sow here a weed, you'll get a weed there. So this man did everything in his kingdom exactly that he would reap those facilities and those fruits. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. And then he goes, جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِ مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. So when you do the amal, you get the heaven. Or if you don't do the amal, you get something else. Let us decide, what do we want to do? But to do all those things is hard work. We have to sacrifice for all that, day and night. The time has to be utilized properly. The time has to be made available so that we do the things that are going to give me the heaven, not the hell. But I can also make this world of mine heaven equally as much as I'm going to have heaven there. Now, Allah has given me this opportunity, and our A'immat Tahireen have showed us. Hussein in Karbala showed that you can have it here, you can have it there. That you can die before death, you can immortalize your physicality, and you can continue with that immortality of your body and the immortality of your nafs to gain eternity with your spirit, so that you are there in front of your ma'bud, that you are there in spirit, eternal in your soul, eternal and in your body, eternal. Sawa Akbar Muhammad. And we find the whole vacuum of Karbala is continued. People were killed. The ladies were traumatized. Their chadors were removed. The children were slept around. The caravan is going to Kufa. On the way, children are falling and dying, and nobody knows. There was a time the caravan is going, and the spear on which the head of Aba Abdullah was put stops. When it stops, Shimr Mal'un comes to Sayyid Sajjad and whips him. Tell your father to move. Baba, you can say it with your word. Why do you have to whip him? He whips him. He is in chains. We talked about that. He says, what's happening? Why is your father not going? He says, I know why he's not going. He says, because his daughter is fallen from the camel. And she's far away. And he will not move without the baby coming back. So Zainab dismounts from the camel, goes back, and what she sees a woman in clad in black. She can't see her face, and Sakina is sleeping on the laps of that lady. Zainab has not seen this kind of mercy for the children. From the day of Ashura till today, she hasn't seen that. She sees that mercy from an unknown person. And she says to her, oh, my lady, thank you very much for doing this. You are very merciful. May Allah give you the jaza of this. This lady opens her niqab and says, Zainab, I'm your mother. Come here. Zainab, I haven't left you. Since you left Medina, since Hussein left Medina, I left my governor and I was with you all the time, all the way. Do you remember you heard my voice crying behind the tent? Yes. Did you see me in your dream that I was sweeping the floor of Karbala with my hair so that my child, when he falls down, it would be clean? Yes, I said, don't worry, Zainab. Take Sakina back and tell Hussein to move forward. ألا لعنت الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون.